If you have your Bibles with you this evening, we ask you to turn to the Gospel of John. John chapter 21. And we're going to begin reading in verse 14. John 21, in verse 14, the Bible says, "This is now the third time that Jesus showed himself to his disciples after that he was risen from the dead. So when they had dined, Jesus saith to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? And he saith unto them, Yea, Lord, thou knowest I love thee. And he saith unto him, Feed my lambs. He saith to him again the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? He saith unto him, Yea, Lord, thou knowest I love thee. He saith unto him, Feed my sheep. And he saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? Peter was grieved because he said unto him the third time, Lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest I love thee. And Jesus saith unto him, Feed my sheep. I'd like to preach tonight, the Lord be my helper on the thought, what would you do for Jesus? Dear Lord, we thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your watch care, the blessings that you give us each and every day. Lord, we praise you for your word. Lord, we thank you that you preserved it for our hearing and for our reading, Lord, and that you would use it this morning to bless your people. Lord God, we pray for the people that sit before us, Lord, that you might speak life to someone here this morning. Lord, for the redeemed, we pray for their nurturing, and for the lost, we pray for their salvation. We pray these things in the sweet and the precious name of Jesus. Amen. Now, reading from some very familiar verses of Scripture, if you know your Bible, you know that at the beginning of this chapter that some of the apostles, or all the apostles, at Peter's bidding, he said, I go fishing. In other words, I'm going back to the way I used to be. I'm going back to what I used to do for the living. I'm kind of done with this whole Lord Jesus thing, and I'm done with it. And so he does exactly that. And the Lord Jesus comes on the seashore and begins to cry out and say, have you caught any fishes? And they hadn't. You know, if the Lord's not in something, it's not going to work. Have you ever thought about that? If he is not the author of it, you might as well not get involved in it anyway, because it's not going to happen. And then he says, cast your nets on the other side. And they got a great draw of fishes that they couldn't even manage with the ship, and the ship was about to go down. And then and only then did Peter say, it is the Lord. Now, it's a shame sometimes we don't recognize the Lord Jesus except in the blessings. Until he does something miraculous, and usually it's financial, because that's how we understand things, unfortunately. Then and only then do we often say, well, it's the Lord. Well, the Lord does other things and works other ways. And as he makes these questions to the Lord, I mean to John, there is a reason behind them. Now, I want to go back, verse 14, it says, this is now the third time that Jesus showed himself to his disciples. Now, at this instance, he presents in a form that they know. The first two times was on the Lord's Day. It was on Sunday, on the first day of the week. This day is not noted. We don't know what day of the week this really occurred on. It's saying that the third time he manifested himself as Jesus. If you remember, on the road to Emmaus, he manifested himself in a different way at a different time. It's not including that time, but they understood and knew that they were dealing with Jesus. You know, it's very important when you find the will of God to understand and know that you're dealing with Jesus. Did you ever think about, I think it's the letter to the church at Corinth. He says, try the spirits, whether they be of God. You need to be under. You need to be certain that you're dealing with Christ. The sad truth is there's not enough preaching on the contrary spirits that are out there and that are reality. And for everything that our Lord Jesus has, I'll guarantee you Satan has a counterfeit. That's how he does things. It's always been how he does things. I often wonder if Satan can come up with an idea on his own, because everything he does is to counterfeit the Lord Jesus. Now, this is the third time that Jesus showed himself to his disciples after that he was risen from the dead. Verse 15. So, when they had dined. Now, I just kind of want to interject there. What they dined on was what the Lord Jesus had gathered and not what they had gathered. In fact, when they arrived on the shore, he already had the fish cooked up. So, it wasn't the fish that they brought, but it was the fish that the Lord Jesus had. You know what? Sometimes you just need to dine on whatever the Lord Jesus gives you, both spiritually and physically. You know, we always want something special for dinner, don't we? Sometimes what we need to do is just be thankful for a peanut butter sandwich. Or whatever it is, something simple, something minute. And, you know, when you're coming to the church, sometimes you just need to hear something simple. We live in a day and age where most people want to be captivated. You know, sometimes we just need something simple. Something as simple as Jesus saves. That would be a good thing. And so he prepares this meal, and they're finished with it. They've eaten the fleshly food. And so when they had dined, Jesus saith to Simon Peter, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me more than these? Now, the these, everybody assumes that he was talking about the brethren. I don't think that. I think he was talking about fish. Do you love me more than the flesh? Do you love me more than the physical blessings that I can give you? Do you love me more than this? Because if you remember, a lot of people, when they were only there for the meat that they got when the Lord Jesus performed the miracles, and when that was kind of up, they were done with it. And so we find here that he says, do you love me more than the event that just happened? And he saith unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest I love thee. And he saith unto him, feed my lambs. Now, he no doubt was talking about the little children of the congregation. You feed them. You give them what they need. Now, we live in a day and age today where lambs are not, you know, first of all, I'll say this. Lambs are not adult sheep. But lambs are not to be caught. You know what? Lambs need to hear that hell is a reality. Lambs need to hear that separate and apart from the Lord Jesus Christ, you will go to hell. Lambs need to hear the reality of sin. And we live in a day and age where they're just petted and doted on. And you know what? This is the problem. They never understand their nature because of that. They think that they're okay. They think they're pretty good. But newsflash for you this morning. You're born depraved according to the Word of God. And if Christ doesn't intervene, you're going to hell. And there's nothing to be done about it. That's the reality of it. And we need to grasp that. So I guess what Peter needed to answer is, what are you feeding them? Are you telling them how good they are? Or are you telling them the reality of their situation? You know, there's a lot of junk being fed to people today. What they need is good, wholesome Bible food that says, you're a sinner and you need Christ. That's what the lambs need to eat. They don't need something that makes them feel good about themselves. They need to understand and know that they need Christ. Verse 16, and he saith to him again, the second time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? And he saith unto him, yea, Lord, thou knowest I love thee. And he saith unto him, feed my sheep, meaning the adult people of the congregation. Now, let me point out to you that every time that Peter always said, you know that I love you. Well, this is the reality. He knew the quality of the love. And that's why he kept asking, do you love me? See, when you really, really love someone deeply, you'll die for them. And you know what Peter did? He died for the cause of Christ. And that is the difference. You know, when we begin to think about love, how much do you really love another individual? How much do you have invested in them? How much do you care about their well-being? How much do you care about them being nurtured? That is really the question. And so what Peter, I think, really came to understand, well, maybe I don't love him as much as I thought I did. Maybe I don't love him in the way that I should love him. Because remember, this was still several days before Pentecost. It really wasn't but probably about 2 weeks from the time when he said, I know not the man. And so Peter really needed to evaluate the type of love, because see, love will motivate you to do things that some people dub as crazy. Love will make you do things you ordinarily wouldn't do. And so we see that Peter had to evaluate the kind of love that he had. Verse 47, and he saith unto him the third time, Simon, son of Jonas, lovest thou me? And Peter was grieved, because he said unto him the third time, lovest thou me? And he said unto him, Lord, thou knowest all things. Thou knowest I love thee. And Jesus saith unto him, feed my sheep. Now, I want you to see the nature of Peter. And he was grieved that he asked him the third time. You know what? You need to ask yourself again and again and again and again, do you really love the Lord Jesus? Because there are times that he's going to ask you to do things that seem contrary to what makes sense. That seems contrary to what the average person would do. That seems different and strange according to what most people think. And almost would not even be rational decisions for the average individual. He will ask you to do that. And that's not popular preaching, but the fact of the matter is it is true. He will ask you to do things so that you'll understand your faith. So that you'll know where you stand, because he certainly knows and understands what level of faith that you have, but he wants you to know that. And so I want you to see that even though it hurts sometimes, ask yourself, do you love Jesus? Do you love him as you should? Verse 18, verily, verily, I say unto thee, when thou wast young, thou girdest thyself, and walkest whither thou wouldest, but when thou shalt be old, thou shalt stretch forth thy hands, and another shall gird thee, and carry thee whither thou wouldest not. Now that almost seems like out of context, and there's some explanation in the verse beneath it concerning the death of Peter, but let me throw you some extra warning out there. If you're not careful as you age, your love will wane. And by that, you're not quite as zealous as you once were. You don't move on the love of Christ like you once did. You're not as quick to respond when he bids you to do something. And so we have a warning there that as we age, perhaps we need to give more attention to what we're doing for the cause of Christ. And so I ask you, when he asks you to do something, because he will, what will you do? What will be your response? Now, very quickly, I just want to read one verse in the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 24. Matthew 24 and verse 12. Matthew 24 and verse 12. And because of iniquity, and because iniquity shall abound, the love of many shall wax cold. Now, again, speaking of a time when your love can impact. In other words, if your love waxes cold, you're not going to be as quick or zealous as you once were. And so he says, in the days of iniquity, and because iniquity abounds, and listen, it's abounding. It's all around us. People have no interest and no care in the things of God. And you look at our nation and the filth that's come up. You have men marrying men and women marrying women, and everybody putting on the pat in their head on the back for doing such a thing. Babies, I think the last I read was over something like 7 million babies died. No, I take that back. 32 million have died since Roe v. Wade. That's a lot of babies. You know what? That's iniquity abounding, just growing by leaps and leaps and bounds. That's a sad, sad commentary for a nation. And so with that iniquity abounding, we can't help but have a love that waxes cold. Listen, and you see it day after day after day, and you become hard. You know what? Y'all probably don't remember this, but the reason I do, it sticks in my mind. Those boys were the same age as my boys. Y'all remember, and I think this was in Alabama, but I'm not sure. It may have been here in good old Tennessee. But a woman ran her baby, had two boys, and they were in a custody battle with her old man. And she didn't want the man to have them, so she left them in the car seats and ran the car off down in the lake and drowned it in babies. You know what? You hear about that now, but that bothered me for weeks. But now you hear about it, and it don't bother you as much as it used to. And you know why? Because iniquity abounds. And so John's gospel gives us a warning. Listen, Matthew's gospel gives us a warning because iniquity abounds, our love can wax cold. And if our love is cold, we're not quick to move. We're not quick to follow what the Lord has given us to do. We don't follow Him as we should. And so He gives us that warning. Gospel of Luke. Luke chapter 23. Luke 23 and verse 26. Luke 23 and verse 26. And as they led him away, they laid upon one Simon, a Cyrenian, coming out of the country, and on him they laid the cross that he might bear it after Jesus. Now, I want you to see this individual that was pulled in to bear the cross of our Lord Jesus. Now, I want you to go over to Mark's gospel very quickly. I want you to get Mark's accounting of the same thing. Mark 15, verse 21. Mark 15 and verse 21. The Bible says here, and they compelled one Simon, a Cyrenian, who passed by, coming out of the country, the father of Alexander and Rufus, to bear his cross. So I want you to see they just kind of grabbed him and pulled him in and made him carry the cross of our Lord Jesus. Now, the question is, do you think that's a menial task? See, it wasn't a pleasant opportunity. It was a mockery. You know, in the days of crucifixion, they were crucifying a lot of people every day. It was their method of execution. And it wasn't something to be desired to carry the cross of another individual. In fact, it was a humiliating thing, and they got the worst of the worst they could grab. So they're going on the way toward Golgotha, and they grab Simon and say, "You're going to do it. You don't have a choice." And I wonder if I would have done it. Now, I'll say this. First of all, with the Roman government, if they picked you, you didn't have much of a choice. But I wonder if he did it with happiness. I wonder if he did it with gladness. I wonder if he did it with willingness. You know what? If the Lord calls you to bear a cross, we should be excited about it. We should be glad about it. We should be happy. And today we live in a day and age today where it's almost a humiliating thing even to go down to the house of God. It's almost a humiliating thing. You can't find people to go with you to preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. You can't find people to go beat on the doors and say, "Listen, do you know that there's a man named Jesus?" Hey, listen, I'm kind of guilty of this myself. A lot of times when I rap on the door, before I realize that all I'm doing is inviting them to church. And there's nothing wrong with that, but the paramount thing is, do you know Jesus? And you know what? I think the reason we don't do more of that is we're just a little bit embarrassed. So, do you pick up the cross and do you bear it? Do you, like Simon, and pick it up and go about the Father's vision? Do you continue on as the Lord has called us to do? Would you be willing to do that, or would that be a little beneath you? Would you be willing to pick up the cross and carry it forward for the cause of Christ, or would you not? And it's easy to say yes until the day comes. Gospel of Luke, again, this time chapter 7. Luke chapter 7 and verse 38. Luke chapter 7 and verse 38. We'll read verse 37. "And behold, a woman in the city, which was a sinner." Now that includes every one of us. We are just like this woman. We are sinners. Some of us are sinners saved by grace, and some of us stand in the condemnation of sin. But just like this woman, "and behold, a woman in the city, which was a sinner, when she knew that Jesus sat and meat in the Pharisee's house, brought an alabaster box of ointment." Now, you know what? That was a very costly piece of merchandise. It was something that some people even estimate a whole year's salary for a box of ointment of the type that she had. She was interested in showing her love for Jesus. She was interested in letting people know that was a priority to her. Now, you think about how we run through money today and the uselessness of the things that we buy. I mean, just before you realize, me and Tom was talking about this the other day. And, of course, things are very expensive nowadays. But you can get a tank of gas. My truck holds a lot of gas. I can get a tank of gas, couple of meals, maybe grab some stuff on the way home she calls for, and $100 be gone. And I often think that there's things better than used for that kind of money. And so thinking about the preciousness of money and this alabaster box, it was very important how it was carried. She brings it in. And I often wonder if we would have been doing the same thing. Verse 38, "and stood at his feet behind him weeping and began to wash his feet with tears." Now, a lot of that is how they were sitting, because, you know, it almost seems like a misnomer, because it says she was standing behind him, like I'm standing behind Joey, and she was weeping, and his feet must have been behind him, because it said that she was crying, and she began to wash his feet. A lot of people think that she was before him doing like this right here. But the best I understand, she was behind him. You know what? I don't think she even thought she's worthy to look at Jesus.
Yeah.
I don't think she ever even made eye contact with him. Now, I'll also show you this. We live in a day and age where nobody cries over the things of Jesus. Nobody cries over the sacrifice that he made. Nobody's brokenhearted over sin. And really, I think her own personal conviction, she was brokenhearted over the sin that was in her life. She realized that she was useless to the things of God. She was brokenhearted, and she was weeping for her situation. You know what? I don't find that very much among God's people anymore. People weeping over their sin state. But that's what this woman was doing. She was weeping over the situation that she found herself, and she did wipe them with the hairs of her head. Now, very, very essential, because again, it took a great deal of humility to do that. And let me say this. You got to have long hair to wipe feet with it. You know when women began to bob their hair off? In the 1920s. And it's not corrected itself since then. 1 Corinthians 11 says that a woman's hair is her glory. And it says it's a shame for a man to have long hair. You know what that says to me? A woman can do something that a man can't. Mm-hmm. Right? Now, there are some things that men can do that women can do in the service of the Lord, but apparently there's some things women can do that men can't do. But again, if you're not equipped, you certainly can't do it. And so we see that this woman sacrifices herself. She has enough compassion and enough grief over sin, and she washes it with her tears, and she wipes it with her hair, and then it says, and kissed his feet. Now, that's an essential thing. You think about yourself, and we don't do this enough. Kissing someone else's feet. In fact, it's a kind of a ha-ha insert. Well, kiss my foot. Right? Do you ever think that had a biblical origin? Because it does. We use it as a laughing insult, but actually it's a testimony of a woman that loved Jesus dearly. She so loved him that she kissed his feet. And listen, it was a day and age where her feet got dirty. In fact, we'll find that the man whose home he was at never even washed his feet when he made the entrance. And that was just a courtesy in those days, as someone would come in off the hot, dusty trails to wash their feet as they entered the house. This man, because he was Pharisee, because he thought he was all so good, he didn't even do that for the Lord Jesus. And what a shame, yet even today when you preach on it, it's still told of the man. Verse 39, And when the Pharisee, which had bidden him, saw it, he spake within himself, saying, this man, if he were a prophet, would have known what manner of woman this is that touches him, for she is a sinner. Now, I want you to also see the self-righteousness that's present. Watch religion, because it can make us very self-righteous. It can puff us up and make us oh so glad. Verse 40. And Jesus answered and said unto him, Simon, I have somewhat to say unto thee. And he said, Master, say on. There was a certain creditor which had two debtors. The one owed him 500 pence and the other 50. And when they had nothing to pay, he frankly forgave them both. Tell me therefore, which of them will love him the most? And Simon answered and said, I suppose he to whom he forgave most. And he says, thou hast judged rightly. And he turned to the woman and said unto Simon, seest thou this woman? Again, that's why I think he's behind her, because he turned and said, now do you see this woman? Do you see this individual? And he turned to the woman and said unto Simon, seest thou this woman? I entered into thy house, and thou gave me yes, no water for my feet, but she hath washed my feet with tears, and wiped them with the hairs of her head. Thou gavest me no kiss, but this woman, since the time I came in, have not ceased to kiss my feet. My head thou with oil thou didst not anoint, but this woman anointed my feet with ointment. Wherefore I say unto thee, her sins, which are many, are forgiven her. She loved much, but to whom little is forgiven, the same loveth little. Now, I want you to think about yourself and what you would do for Jesus. See, some people think they're a little too good to do this or that. Now, we know, according to the Word of God right now, the Lord Jesus is sitting at the right hand of the Father. And so there's not a lot physically we can do for Jesus, right? So who are you going to do it for? Is he going to... Listen, what if he bid you to wash the saints' feet? And I'm using that because that's a pretty menial task, is it not? What if his only work in your life was to clean the bathrooms at New Testament Baptist Church? What if your set purpose was to go and preach the gospel? See, we think about all the tasks that we could do for Christ, and we say, I can't do that. Well, you remember what the woman did. You remember that there was nothing too small. There was nothing that she would not do for the cause of Christ. What would you do for Jesus? What would you do for Him? What would you embrace to be the work that the Lord had given you to do? And many, many times what we do is put stuff behind us. The Gospel of Luke, chapter 19. Luke 19. And I'm going to begin reading in verse 28. Luke 19, in verse 28, the Bible says, and Peter says, lo, I'm sorry, wrong chapter. Luke 19, verse 28. And when he had thus spoken, he went before ascending up to Jerusalem. And it came to pass, when he was come nigh to Bethpage and Bethany at the mount that's called the Mount of Olives, he sent two of his disciples. Now, I want you to see that the Lord Jesus was constantly sending his disciples on what seemed to be very menial errands. Something that was just very routine. And... sometimes they wouldn't do it, or they would question it. You remember at the feeding of the 5,000 what Peter's response was? If we had 300 penny worth of bread, there's no way that we could feed them. See, he was questioning Christ, does he not? And very frequently, we question Christ too. Instead of saying, yes, I'll get the job done, we question Him. Instead of coming down to the house of God and giving great rejoicing that we are allowed to meet once again with God's people, we look around and say, well, boo-hoo, there's not too many people here. You know what? That is a very Peter attitude. You know what? If we have two or three, we're to give Him the praise for it. Because there may be a day that you won't be able to meet at all. And then, therein, you would be interested in giving the Lord the praise and the glory that's due His name. And so we see here that they were given a very simple job. Saying, go ye unto the village over against you, in which at your entering you shall find a colt tied, whereon yet never a man sat, loose him and bring him hither. And if any man ask you, why do ye loose him? Thus say, thus shall ye say unto him, because the Lord had need of him. Now, first of all, I want you to see it took a great deal of faith. Because he says, when you go into the little village, you're going to see a colt tied there. You know, you talk about showing that he was God in the flesh. He knew where the colt was at. He knew that the colt was tied. And I think the Gospel of Mark says he's tied with his mama. Mm. And he says, you go over there and you get the colt. You know what that says to me? No matter what Christ bids us to do, he knows what's in there. He knows, even before we get there, what the response and the end result will be. So why do we question, nothing really happened? Why do you question that? There was really no response. Why do you question that? Why is it that we have to measure things? You ever think about that? Why is it that we have to know numbers? It is a very carnal thing that we do. And so we see then that he gives them, he said, it's going to be set there. You get that. And then he says, listen, nobody's ever been on it before. Now, our little pony, he's mean anyway. And if Bella takes a notion she wants to ride him, I have to walk him about 45 minutes just to get him calmed down enough for her to get on him. And that's a pony that's been ridden many, 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 many times. Can you imagine a colt that's never even been laid on, never even had a bridle, never even had a person set on? He says, you get that one and you bring it to me. Now, in the flesh, what would you have thought about? That thing is going to buck. He's going to rear. I'm going to be lucky to even get him back down here. But the master says, you go get him, and you bring him back to me. You know what? That would have been an impossible task for most. So that says this to me. Sometimes the Lord Jesus is going to ask you to do things that are not reasonable. He's going to ask you to do things that just doesn't make sense. And he's going to test. And when he asks you to do something that doesn't make sense, what he's really doing is testing your faith. Peter, do you love me? Do you love me? And so we, as the Lord's people, certainly would have been then very eager to get the job done. So they go down there, and you know what? Just like the Lord Jesus says, somebody says, what are you doing with my colt? What are you doing with that? You know what? That don't belong to you. That's not yours to take. And all they said, they had faith and says, the Lord had need of it. That's all it took. You know what? Sometimes we just need to say what the Lord told us to say. Jesus saves. Why do we complicate that? Just do what he told us to do. And so, very faithfully, they do that. They bring him, they bring it back to the Lord Jesus. Verse 32, and they that were sent went their way and found even as he had said unto them. And as they were loosing the coat, the owners thereof said unto him, why loose ye the coat? And they said, the Lord have need of him. And they brought him to Jesus, and they cast their garments upon the coat, and they set Jesus thereon. Now, do you get this? Then they went a little further. See, when you began to trust the Lord Jesus and began to be obedient to what he has to say for you, when they got there, they got their fancy coats off, and they created a little saddle, a little cover for it so that the Lord Jesus had a place clean to sit. And they put the Lord Jesus on it. That old pony didn't rear. He didn't buck. That coat just took him down through the Mount of Olives right into the city of Jerusalem. And it says that as he went along the way, they began to lay palms in front of him and laid their coats before him and said, Hail, King of the Jews. They were excited. They recognized him as Jesus. And the very same group, 1 week later, crucified him. It's a very fickle bunch, right? Very fickle bunch. So, I believe really what it gets down to is this. Your love for Jesus really is very proportional to what you do. You know, when I was a young preacher, it kind of upset me when people didn't respond to preaching. It kind of upset me when people would lay out on Wednesday night. It would kind of upset me when there was just no interest. But then, you know what? I found this. What it is, it's directly proportional to the love they have for Christ. Now, they may tell you a lot of different things. The easy excuses is, well, I had to work that night. Billy had a ball game. And all that goes with that. But really, your service is proportional to your love. Do you do what the Master bids you? Does His love drive you to service? Does His love put you in a mode to think, this is what I need to do for Jesus? Do you love Him? If you love Him, I believe you'll serve Him. I believe that's a very easy thing to come to. When I was a young man, I never, ever, ever dreamed that I would preach the gospel of the Lord Jesus Christ. Never even entered my mind. But you know what? I love Him. And He said, go, and I went. That's what you have to do. Do you love Him?